Our next speaker is Pete Hilger, CEO at Allied Solutions, who's here with us to present Accelerating Growth with an Innovative Mindset. Now, Pete leads all aspects of Allied Solutions, including strategic vision and development acquisitions, key industry relationships, and the overall value proposition for clients and partners. Pete served as Allied Solutions President and Chief Marketing Officer before his promotion to CEO in August of 2016. He has more than 30 years of corporate management experience focused on strategic planning, product and service positioning, acquisitions, and partnership development. Put your hands together and let's welcome Pete Hilger.
China has identified the cause of the
mysterious new virus.
Coronavirus.
We've seen huge drops in consumer spending, which in turn has impacted small businesses.
4.4 million American workers quitting in September.
This is me, 15 minutes after quitting my corporate job.
A double whammy coming right after her unemployment benefits were canceled because of a system error.
It has been emotionally devastating.
So right now, what we're looking at is one factor, and that's the COVID-19, the reopening of the economy.
We're here in Seattle, Amazon's day one building for Welcome Day. For many, it's the first time back in the office in years. For others, it's the first time ever.
Americans are falling deeper into credit card debt that they can't pay off.
Consumer confidence, expected to be in the vicinity of 108, comes in lower, 102.9.
Jared, I expect a recession to start in the U.S. in late Q2, so let's say late June, midsummer, basically.
The Fed is going to have no choice but to hike rates even more.
Well, as UBS is set to acquire rival Credit Suisse, the U.S. Federal Reserve teams up with central banks to prevent liquidity issues.
So the entire house of cards was erected by the Fed and the U.S. government, and now it's collapsing, and they're acting like they have nothing to do with it.
The way that we like to look at it is we make the investment in technology that makes it easy for our members to use and increases that experience and loyalty, and in turn just drives that revenue growth, that we continue reinvesting in this cycle.
So what we're seeing is credit unions making sure they have the sources if they need liquidity.
That doesn't bring back a lot of good memories or bad memories, depending on how you look at it over the last 3 years. I don't know what will. You know, I'm almost afraid to turn on the TV right now. I'm afraid that if we turn it on, they're going to tell us it's a giant meteor is coming at us and it could hit Earth anytime over the next 2 years, so we can stress out a little bit about that as well. You know, I remember back in 2019 in the fourth quarter, Allied Solutions said, hey, we're going to be transforming our organization. And so we hired PwC and we spent a significant amount of money. I'll talk a little more at the end of my presentation if we have time on this. But we launched it January 1st of 2020. Now, we had an opportunity come March to pull the plug, because about that time we're all scrambling to work from home, which is going to bring up one of the first challenges I'll talk to you about here in a moment. But we stayed focused, we stayed the course, and we delivered on that transformation of our organization 3 years later, 2 years in the midst of a pandemic, 1 year in the midst of us all working from home. And that focus, that drive, is what I think this movement needs in order to achieve what you can do under a great opportunity that I don't believe you took advantage of in 2008 when the last banking crisis happened. I'm going to talk a little bit about some of the failures that I think the credit union industry went through during that period. Allied lives that same story. I've been representing the credit union movement for 33 years. I've seen the good, the bad, the ugly. You have a wonderful opportunity, but you have some challenges out there. The first one, if you think about it, is the human factor. We have a whole difference of opinion whether you should come to the office or work from home. That could be a whole hour presentation. We could have that debate. I personally think that people need to be in the office, but a lot of you know that who have talked to me. But getting people to work is the challenge. I can tell you in our organization, 5% of our open or total employment base we can't find people to come and work. So what you have to do is you have to start to disrupt things. You have to start looking at what you can do digitally to make your organization less dependent on the human factor. And you'll hear me say this a couple times today. When you start talking about digital, you start talking about artificial intelligence, things are going to go wrong. It doesn't matter how much you prepare, how much you plan, things are going to go wrong. No different than if you have the human factor. Things go wrong. The difference is, with technology, you can fix it and it stays fixed in most cases. And I think that's an important thing to remember as you start to innovate and focus on how you're going to take advantage of this great opportunity that you have today, not tomorrow, but today, and you have to get focused and deliver on it. And we'll talk about the strategy and the commitment to that strategy, and the people commitment is just as important as the investment itself. Economic instability right now, I can tell you that Allied Solutions at some time this year will handle 90,000 repossessions in a single month. Your members and potential members are struggling to make their car payments. You have a huge challenge in how you manage risk management. How do you handle mitigating your losses? How do you leverage what the industry has, because it's minimized itself during COVID? The amount of companies that have went out of business that help provide and support that risk management services for you do not exist anymore. And whether you like to believe it or not, each and every one of you individually as an organization are small players in the marketplace. And if you don't join together and leverage some of the tools I'm going to talk to you about today, you're going to struggle to mitigate the risks that you have out there. You're going to struggle to invest and keep up with the big banks from a digital and artificial intelligence standpoint, and you're going to fall behind, and you're going to lose this great opportunity that we're going to spend some time talking about. Consumer behaviors is the other thing I think that is a huge opportunity for us. Think about the data that you have at your fingertips. Think about the data that all the partners have of your members and of your future or potential members. It's extremely powerful, but you have to figure out how to make data meaningful. There's companies out there that take hundreds of thousands of license plate pictures, called license plate recognition. We can tell you today if your member's gonna get married, because we know that their car was at a bridal store. We can tell you today if they have kids, because maybe they're at Toys R Us, assuming they don't go online and purchase everything anymore. But the data that you have at your fingertips is very, very powerful. Every time you go through a toll road, every time you go through one of those speed limit signs, they are loaded with cameras, and they're taking pictures and getting behavior tests on each and every one of your current members and new members. And then you have my favorite, is the regulatory environment. Half of us don't understand why they're doing the things they're doing. The world is changing very, very rapidly. If you think because you're not 10 billion or bigger that the CFPB isn't looking at what you're doing, they are. If you think that the attorney generals, there's a huge issue in refund liability going on right now, credit unions of all sizes are now being exposed to that. So we must innovate, and I'm gonna really focus on three areas today on how we can innovate. The first one is the brand and market share. And part of it is understanding who you are and what your value proposition is. You can't be everything to everybody, and you have to learn to partner with those people that can help you and can share the cost, because cost in the digital world and technology world is out of control. Allied will spend on an annual basis, depending on how you measure it, and other companies are very similar, $50 to $75 million, whether it be compliance, info security, enhancing technology platforms, building bots, dealing with artificial intelligence. That's a small amount that some of these large entities that we're all competing against are dealing with and able to invest. Digital engagement, Gen Y and the millennials, and you'll see some shocking numbers here in a second, they want to be engaging digitally. In many cases, they don't want to talk to you. And think about one of the most powerful brands that the credit union movement has had over the years, and that is the personalized service that you provide down to each and every customer member that you have out there. How do you do that digitally? And the third one is the strategic partnerships. I can't stress this one enough, and you'll see that there are some great partners that you have out in this industry that are investing millions and millions of dollars. Why we are all not joining forces and utilizing those dollars so that we can afford to compete with the big people. Brand. So many credit unions don't spend enough time on their brand and how they're going to gain market share. The name alone for a credit union can suffocate what the public sees as their ability to do business with you. And one example is University of Iowa Credit Union, Community Credit Union. 5.7 billion, 206,000 members at that time. They changed their name to Green State. Now, I'm sure there's a lot of science and they paid a lot of people to help them figure that name out. Doesn't really matter, because that research that was done has allowed that credit union to grow to 411,000 members and over $11 billion in assets. Now, there were a few thrifts and banks that they acquired, but nothing that was so significantly large that it kind of created a false image of what that success is. And look at all these credit unions down here that have started to change their names. Alaska USA, well, one could have said, all they do business is in Alaska. That's not true. They've been down in Arizona. They've been in Washington. They've been in many states throughout the U.S. But now their name represents a much broader capability. That name change and then the research behind what their purpose is will help you grow, but you can't be cheap about it. You got to spend the money, you got to get your communities behind it, and you have to understand what your mission is and where you're going to fit in within the marketplace. You don't make headlines in a bad way. There's some examples up here of the different headlines out there. And this is that advantage that I really think that if you don't focus, and I'll just make a little bit of a criticism comment here. Credit unions made a decision, many of them, and all my comments, and those of you who heard me speak before, I'm pretty candid. I'm just having a conversation with you, saying things that maybe a lot of people don't want to say openly. I say them. But you're not very responsive right now. From a partner standpoint, getting return calls. We're trying to help you guys out, and there's partners I'm going to show you that are trying to help you out, are the leaders in the industry. And so you need to focus and don't be afraid to leverage and make some decisions, because this window will close like it did in 2008. And it'll close fast. Because the companies that you're competing with on market share have almost unlimited resources out there. But if you look at all these different pieces of information out there, they are doing one thing, and that is deteriorating the trust that consumers have in banks. In 1979, there was a survey done. 60% of all customers trusted their bank. 10% didn't. That same Gallup poll in 2022 said 27% of the customers trusted the bank, and 23% didn't. If that's not a message of opportunity for you, and if you don't wake up and take advantage of it this time, it's a grave, grave mistake on the strategy for growth. I still go out and I'll talk to people, and they'll ask me what I do, and we laugh at my family. It's kind of tough to explain what Allied does. But when we mention the word credit unions, it's amazing sometimes how I see a blank face. That tells me that we're not doing a very good job promoting our services. Navy Federal Credit Union has some great commercials. When you see Navy Credit Union, they have their brand out there, but they also are the largest credit union in the industry, and they can afford to do that on their own. And that, again, is that partnership piece that I really think that you need to embrace and trust. And that trust is one of the greatest assets you have, because your members do trust you. Bottom line, you don't break that trust, your brand is absolutely invaluable, and you should be leveraging that every day. I do believe that credit unions are very positioned to shine. And if you think about the liquidity challenges out there, the things that have happened with Silicon Valley Bank, a couple of the other banks, probably being a little too aggressive, whether they were investing in crypto, doing too much in the fintech area. But again, it's an opportunity for you to take that trust. But look at the pros and cons here. You have lower fees. Most of the time, you have lower interest rates. You have many more consumer-friendly tools out there. And this is the big one. You actually care. You actually care about the financial well-being of your members. And you need to somehow figure out how to get that message out to potential members of your particular field of membership. Or if you have unlimited membership, you have even a broader opportunity out there. The change is the cons. You're losing the battle because of the cons. And you look at the number of people that want to use mobile banking, use that mobile tool. I think the average age of a credit union member today is somewhere between 48 and 52 years old, depending on whose survey you look at. Those are also the people that are part of the Great Resignation. So those are ones that are quitting their jobs and probably becoming more savers at some level. You have to figure out how to engage digitally, mobily, and then it's the breadth of products and services they have. Why is it, and I'll show you the statistic in a second, why some of these groups of people are so unengaged with the credit union marketplace? 36% of all consumers are willing to change their banking relationship for lower interest rates and lower fees. Think about that. Millennials, over 45% of them, 49 to be exact, will change for better loan terms. And you have some great tools out there today that will help offer that opportunity for them digitally. But you need to embrace them. This is the one that to me is the biggest eye opener when I was putting this together. 4% of Gen Z members or consumers, in this case they're just consumers, because 4% utilize your credit union. And what is Gen Z, 12 to 20 something? I'm not sure on the age bracket there. Why is it that 96% of them don't utilize you? When many of you are focusing on financial education and well-being, do you think it might be marketing? It'd be curious to see how many people today could say, this percentage of my budget is directly related to marketing. Marketing my brand and my services out to the community to grow my membership. It's very small. How do I know that? Because we're talking to you every single day. We bring executive teams into our office. We learn your pain points. We share collective pain points that we have together. We have to figure out how to touch them. 5% of millennials are credit union members. Now think about the total population that bandwidth covers. And think about who's in the midst of their highest earning power. It's this group. The difference is they all want to be treated and marketed differently. You have your older members that may not want that complete digital agreement. I personally don't like using my phone as every single tool that I do in my banking relationship because I can't see. I have to keep finding my glasses half the time and you can't figure out what's going on. When you look at digital tools out there, you can't afford them. You can't afford the tools that you need to have to compete. Look at these companies. Many of you do business with these companies. These are just a sampling for the record, because I'm very non-biased when it comes to sitting up here and doing these type of speeches. These are companies that all of your partners today, your key partners, which I'll show you here in a moment, have either invested in or embraced. Why is it then we build a lot of these fintechs? So a company will start a fintech. They'll come, companies like mine, TrueStage, Southwest, State National, and they'll say, tie this into the services that you do and go out and bring it to the credit union market so they can buy it from me, and then I'm going to turn around and sell it for $200 or $300 million. How much do we get out of that? Nobody's writing me checks when they sell a company, even though we may have been key in the distribution. Nobody's writing you checks. So why aren't you grouping together and investing in some of these solutions? The best thing you can do is own. If you own, you help control. And there's enough of you out here where you can afford to buy these. If you look at what Apple's doing, US Bank's doing, I can go on and on. They're buying up these companies, and they're going to control that experience. So I encourage you to look a little deeper on what those opportunities are as part of your overall strategy, because this is going to be something that is absolutely core to controlling your future, your success, and today taking an opportunity of growth. Because if you don't start today, you're not going to catch up tomorrow. It's just simply not going to happen. So now let's talk about the partnerships out there. Your partnerships can be you individually connecting with other credit unions, a lot of mergers and acquisitions going on. But you don't have to do a merger or an acquisition to be a partner. Partner with your credit unions. Partner with your credit unions that may even be in the same market. You're not competing against each other. There are some markets in the credit industry that is mind-boggling to me that they won't even network or talk to each other. You won't even talk to each other. I can't even invite, in some markets, the top five largest credit unions in that market together to have a conversation. Now, some markets do very, very well, don't get me wrong. But why are you thinking your competitor's your own when it's not? Your competitors are these big finance companies, these big banks that have massive amount of dollars, that do not have the trust in your current membership base, but most importantly, your future membership. So you need to step up. You need to get out of the basement, and you need to start looking much broader as to what your opportunities are, because if you don't, you're just going to be a small credit union that's not growing, and the bigger credit unions are going to merge you all up, and the industry and the movement is going to shrink. And I know membership's growing, but so is our population. But how many of you measure how many services? One of the things that's interesting to me is indirect lending. To this day, from a very large credit in Indiana, I still get a statement from my daughter in the mail, for my daughter in the mail. She did a car loan. Now, she's 39 years old. She did a car loan when she was in college. I still get a statement from a military credit union when I was in the military. It has 12 bucks in it. They send me a statement every quarter. Now, I think many of us are well beyond that in cleaning up those members, but why is it that on indirect lending, they usually have a share account and a loan? That's it. You're talking about low-hanging fruit, because it's also going to be part of your challenge when it comes to risk management right now, because I believe that all of us are hearing about delinquencies. I mentioned 90,000 repossessions. Now, that's not just in per month. That's not just in the credit industry. And I'll give you a comparison as to why that's such a dynamic change going on. In the midst of the pandemic, the industry was flooded with money. We had regulatory oversight that didn't let us protect our assets. and delinquency was at an all-time low. If the average car payment today is $670, the average LTV today is about 137%. Many of you don't even know on the indirect side what you're funding. You know you're funding a loan, but you don't know what the components are on the loan. How do I know that? Remember I mentioned that regulatory thing that's going on refund liability? We know that you don't know because we're trying to get the data from you and you don't know. But that's what's driving that LTV up, okay? And these loans are gonna go bad and they're gonna go bad pretty quick. Why don't you take the time to get to know who your member is? Why don't you take the time to get more services for your membership that is just an indirect coming in, but then can be a much broader member that you have? Because you have one valuable asset that the banking industry simply does not have. It's called trust. You have one other attribute that you deliver, and that's you care. Take advantage of it. These partners are all extremely financially strong, without exception. And I know there's others out there, but when you want to talk about your big players in this industry, these are the people that are spending millions and millions of dollars to help grow the credit union movement, to help make you successful, and that are creating, if you go back, I think I can go back, these relationships. Sunday Sky is an example. It's a partner, yes, it's a partner of Allied's. Not trying to be an info commercial here. You could not afford to buy this very dynamic and strong digital engagement tool on your own. They wouldn't sell it to you. But it's partners like this group right here that are aggregating the buying power of this group here so that you can afford it. Now, whether that particular solution is good or not, doesn't make any difference. Posh is another one. Artificial intelligence. TrueStage has invested in that organization. They are aggregating the power of you in their services and their ability to distribute products and solutions for you to help grow the overall credit union movement. So I really think that you should engage and look at them as true partners. Not vendors, not a political tool, but true partners who are in the game with you to grow. And you have to do it now. And I'll bet you some of you are out there saying, what's this guy standing up here telling me this for? We are way ahead of that game. I bet you're not. Because I'll ask you this. As you move through and you ask yourself, are you innovating? How many of you, and this is going back to the very beginning of my discussions, actually can say this. We sat down, identified who we wanted to be, both from a brand and a marketing standpoint. We sat down and understood a vision and direction we wanted to be now, tomorrow, and in the future. And if you're all nodding, saying, oh yes, I've done that for sure, I'll tell you my story in 2019, fourth quarter. OCT, we called it, Operational and Culture Transformation. It was the pillar that's what's gonna allow us to do what we're launching right now in 2023, and that's called One Ally. And it's not cheap. If you think you can do it on your own, and I'm not a big fan of consultants, and we do not provide this service, just so you know, but go out and find a company that you can engage to truly understand what you're gonna look like by 2030. You're gonna spend anywhere from $2 to $5 million if you do it right, just to help walk you through that. Because what happens after they help you develop it, they then make you committed to it. Because you have an entire focused entity helping build your vision and your direction. And they can start helping you achieve that today. And you have to do it today. Because if you don't do it today, you're gonna be left behind. And I can tell you that there are CEOs out there and C-suites that are okay with just status quo. And if you look at your C-suite team and you're really candid and open about it, develop a leadership action plan with each and every one of them, put it in a word cloud so you can criticize each other about it and you can compliment each other about it, and then make them have the human factor commitment. Because you can't do it with a strategy and a plan and a vision. The end of the day, the human factor is the most important asset the credit union movement has. You can buy all the AI you want, you can pay all the technology you want. The fact is, there's still a lot of people that want to talk to you, and there's still a lot of energy that you have to drive to create the overall success of the credit union movement. This is something that I think we should all be proud of what's been created. And I'll close out by saying, if you take just a small part of this serious, and you go back and you do some soul searching within your team, whether you're virtual, combination of virtual, or all in the office, and you're willing to have a healthy debate as to where you think you need to go, where you want to go, and you make it your number one priority, you'll take advantage of this great opportunity that you have that you didn't take advantage of in 2008. You've got great partners, you've got a great organization in NAFCU led by Dan that are there to help lead and direct. They're helped to fight from a lobbying standpoint, the compliance side of things. Do your job to help this movement continue to grow and get stronger. Thank you very much.